Hey everybody, if you're listening, it's 12:28 a.m. Tuesday on Pacific time right now, and I was about ready to go to bed, but I saw something online. It was supposed to be 12 midnight. Julian Assange from WikiLeaks is actually supposed to have a conference, and I'm just watching a screen right now on some website that says Broadcasting Network standby for live video. So I want to go ahead and play some instrumental music, and as soon as this live WikiLeaks Julian Assange comes on, I'll go ahead and take you right to the broadcast live, and we'll see what it's all about on the Michael Tobin Show. If I could get the music queued up, oh, here it is. So go ahead and stand by for Julian Assange.
Good morning, everyone. Joe Seals here in the RSBN studios. We are about to begin our live coverage of the WikiLeaks press conference from Berlin. We are partnering up with InfoWars. They're actually going to use our live feed for the broadcast when it comes. So what we're going to do is put up a split screen for you, and we're going to have Alex Jones live coverage. And on the other screen, we'll have the feed up for the WikiLeaks press conference, which is not has not begun yet, but we'll when it does, you'll see it pop up, and then we'll go straight to that. So we'll let you have some pregame coverage here from Alex Jones and InfoWars. We appreciate them allowing us to do this, and we'll come back on the air as soon as the event is over with.
Never felt so good working this hard. I mean, this is history, and the answer is everybody's got to work hard to educate and inform and to take action, because even if they steal this election from Trump, and I think he's going to win, if he loses, they've stolen it. The evidence all shows that. We're winning by exposing globalism, the New World Order, crony capitalism, the mainstream media. They've all really been decimated by this. There's not going to be any rebuilding this now. So either way, we win. We have devastated them. That's one question. How do you feel? And the second question, the war preparations with Russia and the escalation of crises, what could Hillary's October surprise be, or the globalists, people that control her, what could they pull to try to derail this?
Well, there's not another inch left on my seat, and it's been that way for a long time now with everything that's going on. And like I said, even after the 34 days that's left and we have the election, we'll see what happens. Even after that, I think that it just gets more interesting. But as far as what I think will be leaked, you know, I'm hoping, Alex, that it goes beyond what you talked about, because we already know that information, and I feel like the same paradigm we're seeing with Trump
supporters. Sure, but it validates it.
Well, but I feel like the same paradigm we're seeing with Trump supporters, you know, I'm guilty of this as well. I mean, I'm willing to forgive Donald Trump for things that are not perfect in his past. Obviously, it's nothing near, in my opinion, compared to what Hillary has done. But even if this is vindicative of everything we've said, even if it ties her into Fast and Furious, Benghazi, whatever else, whatever other corruption, Haiti with the Clinton Foundation, I still don't think that her supporters are going to turn away. I still don't think that her supporters are going to be affected. They're going to look at this. They're going to say, oh, that's just more right-wing conspiracies. Just like you were saying, if Hillary Clinton wins this debate, I think it's unarguable that it was completely rigged, okay? Who else do you need to talk to than the people who have been on the ground?
Hillary Clinton's a horrible speaker.
People.
She sucks. Everywhere we go, we show new photos today across the country. No one shows up to the rallies.
No one.
Like 20, 30, 50 people. I mean, my God, ladies and gentlemen, anywhere Trump goes, it's 5, 10, 20, 30, 40,000. Anywhere I go, if I announce 500 people, 1,000 show up.
Twice in Colorado, Trump probably had 20,000 people or more at his
event. And we showed the photos today. She had like 25 people.
I don't understand how that's possible, because I just saw the new polls and she's leading.
Right.
What? It's like the Twilight Zone.
Isn't it crazy, though? Is this our moment? Is this the time for truth to win out?
Well, I mean, that's what's happening. Look, people that are going to be delusional are going into deeper delusion. People that are going to wake up are getting more discerning, more awake. Because, look, we can't hardly find Hillary supporters in the most liberal areas of Austin. Okay, in other parts of the country, it's non-existent. Millie Weaver went in Cleveland to the main Democratic headquarters, and they said, yeah, no one we know likes her, even Democrats. We don't like her, basically, is what they said. They were totally demoralized, totally freaked out. You turn on Fox News, it's like CNN 6 months ago. CNN's like MSNBC 6 months ago, and MSNBC is completely weaponized. But here's the thing. I saw multiple Fox shows. We played a clip during the show today, this morning, where they would say, you know, Hillary only stumbled. She didn't fall. They're going back now doing cover for her with Republican guests saying Trump's really screwing up. By the way, oh, Hillary, it didn't hurt her, you know, that bad. I mean, she didn't fall down or anything. It's like, whoa, you people, like, are really advertising yourselves in the new future to be government shills. I mean, this is embarrassing. So when I see a Hillary supporter go, oh, whatever, I don't care what she did in Haiti, I'm sad for this country that Democrats, who used to be pretty good people when Bush was doing bad stuff, had a conscience. I mean, taking 94%+ of all the money from Haitian kids, man, I actually, that I'm a God-fearing person. That freaks me out. When I think about Hillary stealing 90%+ of the money from the Haitian kids and keeping it for her horrible self, that freaks me out, man. That really gets to me. Darren McBrain?
Well, she did that as head of the State Department. Can you imagine what she will do as president?
Oh, my God.
I mean, it's just anything scary goes.
Well, that's it. That's why I'm so freaked out. It's beyond fear. It's beyond resistance. It's just my whole body is on fire going, resist, do something. Oh, my God, the peril. I realize this country probably isn't going to make it if she gets elected. I think that's really it. My gut tells me, barring a miracle, we're done if Hillary gets in. It's going to be a hard row with Trump. They're going to throw everything they got at him, but it shows we made the right decision. A vote against the media, a vote against the globalists, a vote against the communist Chinese. But if we don't get Trump in, I believe we go under judgment. Owen?
And Hillary's arrogance, to me, is one of the most dangerous things, where if you look at everything Obama's done in the last 8 years, she'll get in and she'll say, well, I can do more than that.
It's a pissing contest with Russia day one.
Completely bring America to its knees. But you know what? I just want to say, I thought that Trump's impression of Hillary falling down was hilarious, even though a lot of people probably thought it was, you know, politically incorrect. I thought that was funny. But, you know, have you ever seen in your life, and I think this shows how desperate they are, like you were talking about, and have you ever seen in your life CNN so pathetic? Have you ever seen CNN or MSNBC just 24/7? It's not even news anymore. CNN is 100% Trump bashing all day long.
And they have almost MSNBC no viewers now. Their lowest show has like 30,000. Their biggest show like 300,000. They're over. This Tonight will conservatively probably have 1 million viewers live by the time it totals up on YouTube tomorrow. Just watch. I mean, Paul Watson has a video, you know, the average one's like 5 million. We have, like, now it's like 20 million views a week just on videos. Their answer, though, is censor us. See, I mean, we're bigger than CNN. They know it. And they're just draining themselves in an attempt to prop the facade up. Again, resistance is victory. Darren McBrain.
Well, I want to flash back to it was a couple of years ago when WikiLeaks released some emails that proved the contacts that exist between the State Department and the motion picture industry. I mean, we're talking Sony Pictures, the CEO, Michael Linton of Sony Pictures.
Oh, yeah, you turn on movies, it's all globalist propaganda, but now it's Chinese propaganda in the movies.
Well, it just laid it out. Michael Linton gets invited to the White House. He hangs out with Michelle Obama, Barack Obama. They have dinner cocktails, and it says, we need your help to, quote, control the narrative. And that goes from ISIS to the Russia and everything all across the board. And so these guys are working together to basically, this is a massive propaganda campaign against the American people.
Absolutely. You know, it goes to this point that Owen keeps making. We have all the facts already in WikiLeaks, but if more info gets released, that's even more dramatic. Will the public even care? Because what we've already been shown and given is bombshell. And so the bar gets higher and higher, where a lot of folks have said if she's caught barbecuing babies on the White House lawn, you know, her constituents won't care. I mean, is there no end to this? Because here's the deal. Some Americans may be delusional and going along with this. The mainstream media may be. But all over the world, people are really freaked out. I mean, 40 million Russians did a nuclear war drill today. Mm-hmm. We're not doing that. They're moving nuclear missiles up to the Russian border. Our government is aiding Al-Qaeda and ISIS in attacks on Russian forces. Things are escalating very, very quickly.
Well, and these nuclear missiles, they're calling them anti-missile defense weapons. But the Russians aren't stupid. They can convert these almost overnight into ballistic missiles. Short-range ballistic missiles.
Well, yeah,
Russia is completely surrounded right now, and they're not too happy about it. They're not afraid to go to war.
Well, I mean, the globalists have already said, we will preemptively attack Russia. That's been the doctrine since Bush was in.
Yep.
And they're moving proxy forces in and overthrowing elected governments. I mean, this is bipartisan lunacy.
And Hillary has the same neocons that have her back, the same military-industrial complex. That's why it's so important. You know, Trump is anti-establishment.
That's right. We have got 19 or 18 minutes now until the WikiLeaks press conference from Germany begins. Now, he is staying, Julian Assange is staying at a South American embassy where he's been for almost 5 years. He's Skyping into Germany to this big community arts theater. The facility, we can show folks images of it in a little while, looks like you know, classical architecture, like the Jefferson Memorial or something. So it's a big facility. A lot of media is going to be there. We've got multiple media feeds, Right Side News, Associated Press, and others. Be sure and support Right Side News, folks. They're all listener supported when you go to there.
Hey, you guys, if you're listening to this, if you're anything like me, all this truth that they're talking about is pretty aggravating, but, you know, sometimes you got to listen to it. Sometimes you got to read it. Sometimes you got to look at it. But anyway, stay tuned. This is the Michael D. Tobin Show. And that Julian Assange is supposed to be coming on live. It was supposed to be at midnight, but this is coming to you from Alex Jones thing, but I'm broadcasting it live. But you know, you want to hear a little bit of trivia? We talk a lot about all this chaos going on in the world, and there's, you know, there's one thing that will bring the Lord back, and that is Matthew 23:39. I have a feeling they're about ready to come on, but check this out. This is pretty cool. One thing will bring back Jesus, and this is him saying, "For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" But you know, that has to be in the heart, you know. No man calls Jesus Lord except first the Holy Spirit draws them. So it's coming. It's coming soon. All right, let's see what this moderator guy is talking about.
They in turn are going to use our live feed of the event, which you'll see pop up in the left-hand corner of your screen on the split screen there as soon as it becomes available, and we'll immediately cut to it. It is supposed to begin in about 15 minutes at 4 o'clock Eastern time. So we'll stay with this for a while, and I won't come back until the broadcast is over with. Hopefully we'll get some good news.
It's available exclusively at InfoWarsStore.com, where you can call 24.
You see, that moderator dude did the same thing as me. I beat him to the draw. I started getting a little getting down to the brass tacks here. Then he kind of figured it'd be a good opportunity for him to let people know who's listening to just hang tight while Alex Jones talks about his little store. God, how much money does this guy make? I'm jealous. Jealous. That's all right. Despise not small beginnings, right? I'm just an unemployed dude trying to bring people stuff that matters. Do it for a living. Doing a new thing. I'm all poised, man. I'm poised. P-O-I-S-E-D. I'm poised. All right, I'm gonna put some of that, what do I do with my music? Here it is. I'm gonna put on some instrumental music. Maybe you should listen to Alex Jones as soon as he shuts up about his profit break. Okay, I think he's talking about stuff now. Hold on, here's Alex Jones again.
That's the whole point. We're doing this together now. In a moment, we can show them getting ready. Let's put on screen our live feed of WikiLeaks press conference. We've got a bunch of different networks. Right Side Broadcasting Network, we can put that up. We have the AP feed as well. You can see our two feeds. Let's put that up full. Oh, I guess Right Side's actually carrying our broadcast. Oh, well, that's great. Well, thank you, Right Side. Yeah, it's absolutely important. In fact, let's pull up their website. Let's go to the bottom of Right Side there on YouTube. Let's click on the More About Right Side, and let's put out their actual URL for TV and radio listeners. Right Side Broadcasting and the URL, folks, is there on YouTube. But let's find the link, because I want this link. I'm going to donate $10,000. I've already promised to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to donate $10,000 tomorrow to Right Side. It costs them hundreds of thousands a week. Have reporters all over the country. Private gentleman has invested his own money they didn't even have. to try to get Donald Trump elected. And it's the American dream. In the last 6 months, right side's gone to hundreds of millions of views and reached so many people, and mainstream media cuts away and won't show the big crowds or won't show what he fully had to say at Detroit or Austin or wherever. Right side's there. And so we're teamed up with right side. Again, I want to get their URL because I'm teleprompter free, and so my memory isn't perfect. RSBN.TV, RSBN.TV. Go there, make a donation right now. Let's put Right Side Broadcasting back up.
Hey, go to my show and make a donation too. I'm out of work. I need some money. Making a Scooby snack here and a Scooby snack there. Days off waiting for phone calls. But I'm still persistent in doing this broadcast thing. Donors.
And then the next week she comes out and says, yes, Alex Jones, you are Dark Heart. I'm coming after you.
Now Fox, too.
Now Fox, they're doing it. So Brett Hume and all these cowards have decided to just follow White House talking points. Not me. Never. I will live on my feet, not on my knees as a slave. So let's go to the right side feed. We've got right side is ready. And again, that's blurred because they've also got us on screen. Let's minimize it and show their dual feed if we can. But right side broadcasting is picking up our feed. We're very, very appreciative of them doing that as well. Amazing patriots. And again, they've got a bunch of different feeds. You'll have millions of views from right side at InfoWars tomorrow. And that just shows we're the true independent media. We're up in the middle of the night while Fox tapes its shows and CNN tapes its shows at like 10 at night that air overnight. We're here giving you real live coverage. And again, I wouldn't care if they were telling the truth at CNN or Fox or MSNBC. They're not. So I've got to work today. No exaggeration. I'm working 20 hours. Because even when I was home with my kids for a couple hours and cooking them dinner and, you know, really focusing on them, the phone was ringing, calls were happening. And I wouldn't do that normally as a father. I was taking my son hunting tomorrow. It was set up a month ago.
Hey, people, if this Alex Jones could do this stuff with his crappy voice, man, anybody could do this. God, I get sick of listening to him after like 3 or 4 minutes. But you know what? The guy's good. He's the dude, you know, you're either called to do something or you're not, man. If you got a, you've got an irritating voice. Well, I've got an irritating voice, too. I think maybe, I don't know. But this dude's, I don't think anybody's got more of an irritating voice than Alex Jones. But you know, if you're called to do something, it doesn't matter, man. If you're called to do it, this dude skyrocketed, man. He's I don't even know how long he's been around. I remember Rush Limbaugh when he first came out, but I have no idea when Alex Jones came out. I just heard of him through some friends, Richard G. White, I don't know, probably 5 years ago, maybe. But I figured you'd probably rather listen to me than listening to him. Listen to Alex Jones. I think he's just stalling for time. He's describing what the little conference area looks like and stuff. Did I hear him say 10 minutes?
Because we don't have George Soros funding us like Media Matters. We don't have General Electric tax exempt and Google.
Man, this guy could talk about donating money for quite a long time. I can't. I just keep it concise. Go to my info. You can see how to donate to me. It's easy. That's me. Me talking, not him. I mean, you could donate to him, too. I'm not saying not to donate to him. I mean, for crying out loud, I'm using his feed. But this is the audio version. I don't have the video going yet. Or I don't have that capabilities yet. But it's not hard to do. It's not hard to get. I just need funds. So I could do this as a... as a living.
Across the United States as well.
Except for I be bringing you things in a biblical perspective too. I talk about current events, politics, sociology, geography, whatever. But I give a biblical perspective because that's what I want to bring to people is scriptural references, mostly prophecy and salvation. And it's kind of like a hobby. My heart is actually in traveling disaster relief with the Billy Graham Rapid Response Team. So I'm getting ready to take off and all that stuff. I just have to have patience, and I never know what's about to happen. I never know what the Lord is going to do until it actually starts to happen. But in the meantime, I get prepared. And you wouldn't believe the ability that I have right now for broadcasting. It's awesome. A friend emailed me and says, hey, be a part of the Fringe Radio Network. And I've got all the premium content now. Wouldn't be hard to add video, but most importantly, I need to be able to travel. All right, let's see how Alex Jones is stalling for time. Waiting for Julian Assange.
And it's all a big joke. He said, how did you know that? And I said, because Media Matters said it, and Fox News now follows their every word. They only attack me when they're told. They don't trust these reporters to attack you when they feel like it with all the other stuff they can do. They only attack when WikiLeaks, not WikiLeaks, that's our Patriot movement, when the globalists put out the talking point at Media Matters. And that's on screen. Alex Jones says next debate is rigged, since moderator Anderson Cooper is admittedly CIA. Then they admit he's CIA, but they don't admit that Trump was right. They turned his mic off to the crowd, were fading it up and down, and Lester Holt 40-something times attacked him, only six times Hillary. It was rigged. So let's play this clip before we go to the live WikiLeaks feed. Here it is.
George W. Bush had debated Democratic nominee John Kerry. A blurry photo of Mr. Bush taken from behind ignited claims he'd been wearing a wire during
blurry.
The debate. Mr. Bush's tailor said it was a pucker in his coat, and Secret Service sources told the Hill newspaper that it was a strap holding a bulletproof vest in place.
Maybe, okay.
But the conspiracy theories, never quite went away. Now, as we reported last week, they are back again, this time about Hillary Clinton at the debate, and our report last week did not succeed in dampening them. For the latest, on the latest theories, here's Fox News Chief Washington Correspondent James Rosen. James?
I go, what is Lester Holt doing? Something's wrong with his earpiece.
With only days to go until the second Trump-Clinton debate, many remain focused on the first one, with fresh allegations of conspiracy sprouting like weeds. Alex Jones of Infowars.com zeroed in on moderator Lester Holt of NBC News.
Back this up 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. He's saying, say that again. It is an earpiece, not a lav.
Say it again? Mm-hmm.
It is an earpiece. The Replace Commission said no earpieces. He's clearly getting orders when he attacks Trump later. And then they put the earpiece back in, they clip it back on his collar and put it back on. These people think we're such morons.
In fact, the Commission on Presidential Debates published no rule forbidding the moderator from using an earpiece.
The news said they did.
One that forbade anyone to speak to Holt through that earpiece.
Water wet,
who
Alex.
Was not Marty Slutsky, the Commission's executive producer since 2000.
Notice the light inside the podium there.
Still other theories have focused on the podium used by Democratic nominee Hillary Clinton, with some pointing to what seemed like an inordinate amount of attention paid to it in the minutes preceding the main event, and others suggesting Clinton benefited from a built-in teleprompter, sending her talking points in real time, complete with a controller of some kind.
Look at Hillary's podium. There's a light that is turned on right now. And there...
She was definitely given hand signals to Holt. He definitely interrupted over and over again.
She's scrolling on the podium.
If the Clinton campaign had decided they wanted to put some sort of secret mechanics into the podium, it would have been a really foolish route to take because people would have found out and it would have made Hillary look
terrible. Not if the system's working with her, but I'm not even saying that.
People would have found out.
Look, they create these straw man attacks. We're about to go live to WikiLeaks. It's about 5 minutes away.
Tell them, and they think...
Yeah, I'm sure Betsy Woodruff would report on it.
Late today, we heard from Frank Fahrenkopf Jr., one of the co-chairs of the Commission on Presidential Debates, who told us each podium was outfitted with a light, as well as notepaper and a pen, standard issue for each nominee. But, Britt, no teleprompters. In full disclosure, I just used one to deliver that tag.
And I have an earpiece.
Me as well.
So do I.
Well, there you go. So we've obviously reported
the conspiracy. Now he does the Media Matters.
Let me ask you about another theory that arose, which is that we noted last week that a man we discovered was Brady Williamson, longtime Democratic aide, worked on many campaigns, working on the Hillary campaign.
Dated all the way back to the 80s.
Back to 1984, in my memory, came out and he picked up notes that were on Hillary Clinton's lectern, which she was entitled to write during the debate. There he is. You see him there. And he picked up her her notes. And right. Later
it was alleged that he then handed them off to Lester Holt, which was proof of some nefarious conspiracy. But if you know, so there he is. That's Brady Williamson, the longtime Democratic operative, taking Hillary Clinton's notes after the debate has ended. And the allegation was that he was then.
Hey, you guys, you know what I'm realizing? This is like history going on right now. It's like 12:59 a.m. It's 1 a.m. now, Pacific time, here in Southern California where I'm at. It's 4 a.m. on the East Coast. Where is Alex Jones? This has got to be history for him. When's the last time he's been up this early? He's burning the midnight oil on the show. That's probably a first. Anyways, we got people just chit-chatting. He's playing, rehashing a bunch of accusations and everything that you could actually read about. You could go to his website for sure and read about all the stuff that he's talking about and the videos he's replaying. It's all about the election debate stuff, the debate tactics from mainstream media, debate tactics and all that other stuff. But you know what's most important right now that's really going on is it's in Syria. The United States and Russia just obliterated their cooperation in Syria. So, you know, Turkey is running loose inside Syria right now. Syria is going to end up bombing Damascus, according to biblical prophecies. And then after that, Turkey is going to end up bombing Damascus. After that, they're going to end up attacking Israel. And it's soon. All this stuff is really soon. You can check out my Facebook. Go to Craig C. White on Facebook and you can read all about it. He explains it way better than I could. Here it is. Press conference in Germany.
Put that full screen. Just go to that with some background noise like C-SPAN does. As we wait to hear the introduction of this live feed. WikiLeaks 10-year anniversary press conference.
It's supposed to be Julian Assange, too. So some embassy in Germany has got a screen on the wall. Somebody's going to be introduced, and somehow I think they're supposed to have Julian Assange patched live video. So the room that you're going to be seeing all day tomorrow on the news and everything, it's going to be a little conference room. This is reminding me of a Jerry Lewis movie where you could hear the water pour in a jug. Maybe that was Liar Liar in the courtroom.
And you're moving off. You're not hanging out going,
Well, what do you make of them following this talking point that I'm saying the debates are rigged that the White House put out yesterday? In less than 5 hours, Brett Hume is out there following with a whole scripted report.
Well, that's how they can go, look, it's totally ridiculous. There's nothing going on. And that's all they have to say in their minds. Even though people are pointing out stuff.
Imagine being Brett Hume, though, where they don't get to do their own reports unless it's on a thing that matter. It's on puppy dogs or, you know, travel, it's fine. You can actually go in the media and do your own reports if that's the case. But if it's on politics, you get a script handed down to you.
Not at InfoWars.
Imagine how pissed they are that we're... Are there any teleprompters around here?
No, and in fact, they won't even let me, like, write down a cue card or anything. Some of the great people down here, they say, nope, that's not how we do it. You got to come on and let your soul and your spirit speak. I still can't believe it. And we've seen this before on mainstream news. They're going to present you the evidence. They're going to show you it. And then they're going to say we have no evidence.
It doesn't exist. It doesn't exist.
That's right. Let's put WikiLeaks back up. While we're speaking, leave that on screen. We'll talk over it. We got a lady opening the mineral water here at the 10th anniversary. We got play-by-play. Now we have a German journalist. I think she's the lead.
They literally spared no expense on this production here, Alex.
Now, by the way, if you're a new listener or a new viewer watching us at InfoWars.com/show, spread that link. We're getting ahead of the mainstream media tomorrow. When they have all their spin and talking points, we'll have the biggest nuggets pulled out of this for you at InfoWars.com/show.
You're not hanging out going,
Well, what do you make of them following this talking point that I'm saying the debates are rigged that the White House put out yesterday? In less than 5 hours, Brett Hume is out there following the whole
thing. You guys somehow are doing a loop from the last hour.
Right side's feeding us our audio. We're going to switch to the AP feed real quick.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. All right, we're switching to the AP feed right now. Right side's doing a great job. And then we are going to continue here. Let me break down for you at this press conference, this legendary, historic press conference by the very brave hero Julian Assange that is about to begin. They're going to go for 15 minutes until he speaks. Then he's going to do a press conference for 30 minutes. We're going to basically carry this unfettered at InfoWars.com/show with limited comment or if any shenanigans break out. And then we are going to have comment after the press conference, which will be over at about 4:40. They're a little bit behind starting, so I would guess about 4:40 it's going to end. We'll do 20 minutes of analysis and commentary after, longer if you guys want, but I'm going to let you guys sit here and basically steal my thunder. Well, I might stay, but regardless, it's not that I don't want to be here, it's just that...
Yeah, I'm stealing Alex Jones's thunder a little bit, but you know, if you've read any of the reports from today, it was all over the news, the internet and everything, that Hillary Clinton had some sort of a veiled threat against Julian Assange. I haven't read it, but supposedly she said that somebody should shoot the guy with a drone from somewhere where he's at, but maybe he's afraid to come out. Maybe he's afraid to go live. Who knows?
Time we've done two live events like this in one day, so this should be another epic day.
You know, I wonder if they'll pull something like jamming his Skype and communications, which they admit they're using the NSA against him, so that Assange can't
Sorry
even
for
communicate
the delay. I was just waiting
to this
for
event.
One of our He's speakers supposed- who's just held up, but there's further held up, so we will just begin anyway. I won't waste any more of your time. Thank you very much for coming. It is the anniversary of 10 years of WikiLeaks starting today. And this is the first showing of a video that we have for this.
Anyway, welcome to the State Department. I think we have some interns in the back. Welcome. Good to see you in this... exercise and transparency and democracy.
A decade ago, we knew a lot less about the world's powerful leaders and institutions. We knew only what they wanted us to know.
Don't worry, be happy.
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 We didn't know how casually they broke the law or stitched up trade deals, how routinely they conducted mass surveillance or kidnapped, indefinitely detained, tortured, or even murdered people. But then...
The whistleblowing website WikiLeaks...
WikiLeaks is getting ready for a bombshell...
WikiLeaks? Julian Assange?
The guy ought to be... And I'm not for the death penalty, so if I'm not for the death penalty, I'm going to do it. Illegally shoot the son of a...
WikiLeaks.
I think the man has a high tech courage.
Julian Assange founded WikiLeaks, a media organization unlike any other. In one decade, WikiLeaks has published more secret documents than all the rest of the world's media combined. WikiLeaks has published more than 10 million documents, more than 10 billion words. If you print them out, they would reach the center of the Earth and then come out the other side. To celebrate WikiLeaks' birthday, here are the top 10 greatest hits, 10 publications that helped us all better understand the world we live in. In 2007, WikiLeaks showed us inside Guantanamo Bay by publishing the manuals and standard operating procedures used to hide prisoners from the Red Cross, as well as PR guides used to eliminate certain words like suicide or to rename a hunger strike as voluntary fasting. 500,000 documents make up the Iraq and Afghanistan war logs, the most detailed description of war to have ever been published. Each attack and death is listed, including 15,000 kills that had been kept secret from the public. When European oil company Trafigura dumped illegal toxic chemicals in the Ivory Coast, it convinced a British court to gag the BBC and the Guardian. WikiLeaks published the gag documents, breaking the censorship ban. In 2010, WikiLeaks revealed how a US Apache helicopter killed 18 people, including two journalists and people in a van driving children to school. What shocked the world was the video game commentary of soldiers eager to kill.
Look at that, right through the windshield. Oh yeah, look at those dead bastards.
The children from the van were severely injured in the attack. Their father and the other adults in the van were killed.
The United States strongly condemns the illegal disclosure of classified information.
Later that year, WikiLeaks released over 250,000 secret U.S. diplomatic cables about every country in the world. Cablegate exposed wrongdoing on every continent. WikiLeaks exposed the largest international agreements that the world has ever seen, the three big T's, which are being negotiated in secret. The three big T's are big business's new strategy to bypass the World Trade Organization and ensure that they get to set the international rules of what other countries can and cannot do.
Today, WikiLeaks begins its release of emails documenting the private lives and private lies of private spies.
WikiLeaks revealed the inner workings of private intelligence company Stratfor that provides advice to US government agencies, arms companies, and Dow Chemical, who hired Stratfor to spy on the victims of the largest chemical disaster in history caused by their plant in Bhopal, India. With the 2.3 million emails published in the Syria files, including the emails of its head of state Bashar al-Assad, WikiLeaks revealed the true nature of the Syrian elite. The Syria files also shed light on how Western companies profited from Syria by breaching sanctions. WikiLeaks revealed the US National Security Agency spying on world leaders, including Chancellor Angela Merkel of Germany and the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, the last three French presidents, and President Berlusconi of Italy. Finally, coming in at number 10 are the emails of the US Democratic National Committee, which showed how the DNC undemocratically and illicitly stacked the deck against Bernie Sanders. As a result of those leaks, the DNC's five top heads rolled. For the 10 million documents published, and the 10 million more to come, let us all wish WikiLeaks a happy 10th birthday. To help WikiLeaks publish the next 10 million documents.
All right, you guys, had I known that this was going to be WikiLeaks' 10-year anniversary celebration, I kind of would have been a little bit more privy. See, that was just a little presentation. There, supposedly, Julian Assange is supposed to be introduced on a white screen from wherever he's supposed to be videoing from.
More secret documents than the rest of the world's media combined. Sorry to everyone in the room. They cover information about every country on the world.
And we've partnered to bring these revelations out with over 100 media organizations over the decades that we have been around so far. We're going to be celebrating over the next 10 weeks with new events being announced all the time, quite a number of supporter of activities that people can get involved in. We have promotions on our book, the WikiLeaks files. This is the hardback copy, but the paperback is about to be launched. There's a lot going out over these next 10 weeks on the sort of supporter community side. We actually have some quotes coming in, some happy birthday quotes. There's one.
So this lady, she's sitting in a room with the audience, press most likely, and she's in some, I think an embassy somewhere in Germany, and with the screen, video screen on the wall, and she's plugging in a whole bunch of stuff about the WikiLeaks website, books and all kinds of things. She's stalling for time. Supposedly Julian Assange is supposed to be introduced for the world to hear and to see, and he's supposed to have some sort of information that's going to be damning to Hillary Clinton. And had I known that this was the 10-year anniversary, I would have been a little bit more privy and a little skeptical and suspicious. Maybe it's a publicity stunt just to further the popularity of the WikiLeaks website. So this would be a real heck of a note, because it's already 4:14 a.m. on the East Coast, and it's 1:14 a.m. here on the West Coast where I'm at. And people are up and at 'em. Everybody's all amped out right now because of this. But in Germany, you say it's 7 hours ahead of East Coast time. So it's almost lunchtime over there, so they're okay. So if this turns out to be just a little plug for WikiLeaks, maybe the H word, a hoax, just so they can celebrate their 10-year anniversary. We'll see. We'll see how the validity of Julian Assange holds up after this, if this turns out to be just a publicity stunt. And Hillary would love that. But so far, has anybody really cared about Donald Trump's taxes? Or has anybody cared about Kim Kardashian being robbed in France today, yesterday? Talking points for the news. But I don't know. I don't care about anybody's tax returns. And it is sad that somebody got robbed by gunpoint, but who knows? Maybe she didn't get robbed. Maybe that's just a publicity stunt too. It's hard to believe anything you hear on the news. But at least most people are not getting their source of news from mainstream media anymore, for obvious reasons, many obvious reasons. I'm more concerned in praying for Israel, praying for Syria, praying for North Africa, all the Middle East, praying for our country. Praying. That's what I'm more concerned about, is praying and being aware of what's going on in the world to the best of our ability to know, without being places that are being reported on. Okay, this lady's talking about current events, so without further ado, let's listen in to her.
On the German press, the 2006 report, compiled by a former federal judge, investigated spying on journalists by Germany's BND, the Secret Intelligence Service here, which is forbidden under German law. The missing pages contain detailed descriptions about the BND's contacts with Focus magazine. The code name Jerez for one of the journalists there was Huffelschulter, who was in contact with them quite a lot, which was shown through these documents. We also released just a year before that, in 2007, the Stasi files, showing that the Stasi was still in charge of these Stasi archives. Then we moved through and we started getting a new trend coming in 2010. We started getting a large lot of document sets that were large archives. We began quite famously in 2010, Collateral Murder. I joined the organization just after that, and I was part of one of the first of these large archives, the Afghan War Logs, that we put out in 2010. That was over 90,000 reports from the war in Afghanistan, from the US troops on the ground there. This was the first time that a media organization was publishing such a large set of documents in this way. It was a first for us at that time, but has a trend that has just continued and has grown. A few months after that, we published similar reports from Iraq, 40,000. These showing, for example, one such revelation from these reports was that the US government would not be reporting a number of instances of torture abuse claims that that were received. And then later that year, 250,000 cables. These were diplomatic documents from the US State Department. And we began in 2010 with publishing 250,000 cables. This was a publication that ended up with 100 media partners. We were publishing for several months. This produced amazing results all around the world. A couple that showed the impact. For example, it's, the cables have been cited by Tunisian academics for having contributed significantly to the revolution in Tunisia. They also were one of the main bases for immunity being withdrawn in Iraq. The Prime Minister at the time explained that this was a reason, the information in the cables, for them taking away immunity for US troops. And there's an interesting case which really showed us and started to develop our publishing model that we have been finessing over the last several years. And what we realized with Cablegate was that actually if one is just working with media, and as much as that does help on an impact side initially, there is a huge impact for archives, the very nature of them, of people being able to explore full archives and see trends in documents, is not only allows for more stories and information to get out that wouldn't otherwise be picked up by media, but is actually very empowering for the public. There was a case specifically that showed us that if we just allowed waiting for headlines, then the stories that all deserve to come to the forefront wouldn't necessarily. There's a German citizen, Khaled El-Masri. He happens to have the same name as a suspected terrorist. And he had been, while he was on holiday in Macedonia, kidnapped by the CIA, secretly renditioned, tortured. And then after several months after they discovered that actually they had the wrong person, he just happened to have the same name, the CIA just sort of dumped him out on the road. And he had terrible trouble trying to get a court case up. The US just said he had no standing, there was no documentation about the secret rendition, etc., etc. In the end, although partners did not pick up those cables to publish them initially, when we put out the entire set of Cablegate unredacted, he was able to go through, him and his legal team, they found the documents that were actually able to get them, and they were able to use them in the ECCHR case that he took that was eventually successful. And this really started to show us the value of publishing these full archives, not just searchable, but the full archives so that the public can interact with them. And this is something that we've kept on with doing, and you will know a number of our more recent releases, the DNC emails, Hillary emails, etc. We are keeping with this, having understood the value of publishing full large archives. Of course, for this, we got quite a number of attacks. The biggest and most interesting for me that we get, obviously we get DDoS attacks, and technically people try to take us down. We're very successful and always have been at staying online. We don't unpublish documents, our links aren't broken. But the one that was most interesting to me are the propaganda attacks that we get. And we've been living with these for several years. The first one that we were hit with when I joined was the blood on your hands with the Iraq war logs, which I found just incredible even at the time. We were literally publishing the deaths at their hands of tens of thousands of people, and somehow this was turned around, that because we explained to the world that the US were knowingly doing this, we somehow had blood on our hands, which of course is not true at all. And what was interesting with this story, that still is occasionally repeated, although predominantly people have come to understand that it is just based on a bunch of lies, was that actually this point was brought up in the trial of Chelsea Manning. And the US government tried very hard to try and show in that trial that there had been any harm done from any of these publications. This was something they wanted to use against Manning and, of course, Julian and WikiLeaks. And what was interesting was that the US government themselves, despite having successfully brought up this talking point, were actually able to find no evidence of harm. And you can see some of the quotes here, and there it became very clear in the trial that actually even the US government don't have any facts to back up their point. And we've seen these sorts of propaganda attacks continue. We're going through quite a large one at the moment. Doesn't surprise us at all. We've also come to understand quite a large trend with these propaganda attacks, that every time we're about to publish, or we're publishing large things, or we're in the middle of a big investigative partnership with a large archive that's coming out, and it's very clear in the power that this is coming, and the powers that be, or the organization that we are publishing about, whose lies and secrets we are revealing, does start in this big propaganda spin against us. And so with the large amount of documents that are clearly coming, that Julian has made a few small references to recently, and of course some have come out, the DNC emails, etc., of course, as is usual for us, a large spin machine went into play against us. And there have been, it seems, quite some digging through past publications. There really is, it seems to me, quite a concerted attack to go in through and just try and find anything. Of course, as is usual, when you start to pick them apart, none of these actually work. I'll just look at a couple of them now that have come out recently, just to illustrate, I suppose, how easily falsifiable and based on no facts, so just spin. And it is interesting to me that it is all happening at this time where clearly we are at quite a height of publication. So for example, Russian agents, I'm apparently a Russian spy, we don't publish anything on Russia. Apparently it's a bit too difficult to Google WikiLeaks Russia and see the 2.3 million emails that we've put out exposing Assad's regime, because apparently we were not publishing on Russia and Syria, or the 650,000 documents that we published on Russia. That was apparently a bit too difficult to fact check. What's another good one we've had recently? Oh yeah, the Turkish one. Oh, this was funny. So then there was a big hoopla online because apparently we published some data on Turkish women, and everybody was getting very upset, and it was personal, etc., etc. The most amazing lack of fact-checking here, what was being referred to was not even anything that we'd published. And in fact, the person that did publish it actually stated that it wasn't us, that they'd published it, and they had now removed it after this criticism. But apparently, well, we'll just ignore the tweet, we'll just ignore people explaining they published it. No, no, no. We'll attribute it completely falsely to WikiLeaks and try and get up this this spin. So for us, these sorts of attacks are quite interesting. It's interesting to see the type of reaction and spin one gets. As I say, these are always, we've seen the trend, it is a reaction from an organization or entity that we are publishing about. They are bringing it up in defense, and so it is actually interesting for us generally to see the types of attacks, the type of spin and propaganda that is tried to be worked up, because this actually tells us even more about the organization, interestingly enough, that we were revealing about in the first place. As long as journalists are willing to not fact check, we're willing to do it afterwards. And we've learned that the main lesson through this is, through these propaganda attacks, is just keep publishing. We publish real documents, true documents, source documents. They speak for themselves. The public can interact with them themselves. And that is, and always has been, and is now 10 million or 10 billion, depending on if you prefer words or documents, that many times that we have been proven correct on this. And so we will keep publishing. It has been 10 years and 10 million documents so far, and there are a lot more coming. We've got Julian will be speaking a bit more about that in a second. But right now, we're just going to hear from one of our media partners briefly. The other one was due to be joining us, John Goetz. Sadly, he's been held up. Oh, no, he's here. Just at the last minute. Grand entrance, hey, John. I know you again. Stefania and John, if you'd like to come and join me. So John Goetz is a German journalist here, and Stefania has come from Italy, and they're just going to say a few words about working with WikiLeaks as media partners.
Okay. Can you hear me? Okay, good. So, good morning. I'm here not because I have special wisdom. I'm a journalist like you. I just want to share my experience of 10 years of WikiLeaks. I spent the last 7 years working, partnering with WikiLeaks, working on all the releases from the Afghan war logs to the latest releases. So I have quite a lot of experience. And
Stefania Maurizi, and it'll also be on the slide at the end, and it should be in, if you've got one of these packs, it should be there, but Stefania.
Yeah.
Stefania
Maurizi? Yes, I'm working.
Yeah, it'll be on the slide at the end, Stefania Maurizi.
I'm working for the Italian news magazine, The Express, and the Italian Daily, La Repubblica. So, basically, it all started in 2007 when one of my high-value sources was basically destroyed, had very serious consequences, just for contacting me, just for trying to contact a journalist. So at that point, I realized that the well-established techniques to protect sources which journalists use are no longer working. We need something better. So, I'm a mathematician. Before journalism, I got a degree in mathematics. So I have good sources in cryptography. And one of my high-level sources in cryptography told me, well, you should have a look on that bunch of lunatics. And the lunatics were the WikiLeaks guys. The WikiLeaks had just been established, so very, very few people knew about even the name of WikiLeaks. So that top-level source in cryptography put WikiLeaks on my radar screen. And I started looking at this organization, their work, how they were publishing things, how they were basically operating. And I got very interested in their methods and their in their approach to journalism, because it was a good approach, a very different approach to journalism. And suddenly, in 2009, July 2009, at 3 a.m. in the morning, someone called me, "We are WikiLeaks." Okay, could you please get up and go to your computer, because we have a file, and you need to get this file before it is too late. Please go to your computer, and could you please help to verify the authenticity of this file? So I went to the I accessed this file and realized that it was very important. It was a file about the garbage crisis in Naples, probably how they were. You know this crisis because it was basically operating around the world. And it was basically the alleged role of the intelligence services in this crisis.
A good approach, a different.
So I realized
that 15, 20 minutes, we're going to get to that. Let's fade this down. We've got raw feeds from Right Side News on Infowars.com if you want those. Infowars.com/show is our mixed feed with our analysis here. It is 3:31 and 45 seconds Central Time. That's 4:31 Eastern. Assange is coming up in about 15 minutes. Then he speaks for 10. He does a press conference for 20. Then we give analysis after. Paul Watson. Paul Watson should probably pop in with us here pretty soon. I know he's up and working and agreed to come on. What did Paul Watson say? You're kidding. Okay. Well, tell him not to worry about it then. Okay. But regardless, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here with our crew. I am here in Austin, Texas, broadcasting worldwide. And we have WikiLeaks here in the background. A lady in broken English from Italy. I don't blame her. I can't speak Italian. Going into what her sources went through, the harassment, what it's been like. She's here humanizing WikiLeaks ahead of Assange, about to join. Let's go to Darren McBreen. Here we are at 3:30 in the morning covering this. This is history. Again, how hardcore is the data dump he's going to give on Hillary?
Well, I hope it's super hardcore, but you guys were talking earlier about how a lot of times you go to these news websites and you get more information in the comments section. And then, Alex, you said that a lot of times what they'll do is they'll turn off the comment section so nobody can read it.
Yeah, that's the new architecture.
But they're even going a step further. Hillary Clinton, she now has a troll army. So what she will do is they've got all these people that they're spending millions of dollars for these trolls to go to these news websites, to go to Infowars.com, to go to Facebook, and to argue with people and of course, they're pro-Hillary. And they basically attack anybody who has anything to do, anything against her. So these are paid trolls, an army of paid trolls.
Owen Schroyer, what's your view on this?
Well, Darren is completely correct. They have to pay these people to go online. You can
Soros does.
Soros does. This is actually a David Brock founded PAC. David Brock founded Correct the Record, which is what you're alluding to, Darren.
Mm-hmm.
And it's now operated by Elizabeth Cohen. Millions of dollars going to these people. You can look at all their financials online. And you know what? As we're talking about David Brock here, you know what's amazing? That's something I don't think it's said enough.
And by the way, let's put the WikiLeaks press conference kind of lower corner if we can so folks know what's going on. We're covering that, but go ahead.
So Fox News calls you out. MSNBC calls you out. CNN, whoever calls you out, and you respond. Hillary Clinton calls you out, says you have a dark heart. You respond with an
and they never covered it.
Okay? I called you a money laundering thief, David Brock.
Yeah, notice he won't respond.
Where are you?
Because he doesn't want to go there.
If somebody said something that damning about myself, about my personal record, I think that I would want to respond. So here you go.
No, he won't respond to any of the reports you were covering.
So, David Brock, I'm accusing you of money laundering. I think that you are an absolute thief. You are the Jordan Belfort of the Democratic campaign donation funding. You and Mary Bonner need to be audited and looked into by the IRS and probably put in jail. Okay? Let's hear you respond to that. I bet your dark heart has nothing.
But look how he's a total moron. He looks he looks like a lobotomized dog with that fake fop hair, like he's an intellectual.
He's got a nice
wig. He looks like a dog in the headlights. I mean, look at that joke. He has that stupid gray hair, like a Mars Attack space alien head. What the hell's going on there?
He doesn't care about anything else except money, all right? That's all this guy cares about.
And he loves Vienna sausage.
Well, okay.
No, I mean...
Hey, his ex-boyfriend actually blackmailed him and...
No. He's a connoisseur of Vienna sausage. I mean, he actually likes little canned meats.
Okay, well, like, are you talking about mini weenies, or does he like...
Yes, mini weenies.
He likes the mini weenies?
David Brock likes mini weenies.
When David Brock has one of his super PACs...
When he has thought bubbles, it's about being a sausage.
When he has his super PACs hosting these parties, actually, he serves miniature weeners at his party. But, hey, he got blackmailed by his ex-boyfriend. He had to pay his ex-boyfriend $850,000.
I mean, he's a connoisseur of breakfast sausages.
Well, regardless of what you meant or what you said, I mean, he did get blackmailed by his ex-boyfriend. So he's got that going for him, though.
I totally agree. McBreen, you want to pop in here? Hey, about Daria, you want to pop in? Rob Dube, Marcos Morales, anybody?
Come on, let's call David. Let's all call David Brock.
I can easily dominate this entire discussion. Let's everybody knows I can.
Hey,
who wants to talk? I've already talked about mini weenies. Go ahead, Dube.
Well...
I fixed my jacket there.
I had my jacket off for a second. But just watching, you know, watching WikiLeaks put this thing together, I'm surprised they haven't just come out with the lead with the big guns. You know, what? I don't know what this party is going
on. Well, they've
on.
Already released some incredibly powerful stuff.
They have, but you would think that the stuff that they're talking about and the buildup that has been to this 10-year
anniversary. Well, they're just giving a history.
I hope they're not trolling anybody is what I'm saying. I hope they're not trolling the world right now.
But, I mean, what could they possibly
break? Real quick, let's go to
this
guy. Let's go to journalist John Goetz. Here he is.
And, you know, I think in some of the announcements that I work for WikiLeaks or something like that, that's not true. Just want to make that very clear. I'm a journalist that works for NDR and for the Süddeutsche Zeitung.
And it says that in the announcement. I'm not going to be mean, but I love these liberal journalists, even ones that have good hearts. It's always how the facts are straight up front. They got to correct you like they're the boss right away. WikiLeaks said investigative German-based journalist John Goetz. They said it right, man. Good God. Let's go back to him. Here, I knew that was coming. As soon as I saw him.
Continued today in my capacity where I work now. And we've worked with WikiLeaks on some of the releases. We haven't done all of the releases. There have been, you know, and basically we look at each release at a time, and we look to authenticate and
it's all about his integrity. WikiLeaks has all been documented.
And then we decide.
It's had an incredible track record.
Example, if we're going to
just throw it on WikiLeaks, just don't.
And it just when I look back
I'm just curious,
at the last
is it 3 a.m. his time too? Because he looks like he just rolled out of bed.
No, it's 10:38, which is the night for him.
Very naive about encryption, about the safety of emails, the safety of downloading documents. I remember at the
time. No, that's the great part. WikiLeaks shows us how this whole surveillance grid has bringing down the system itself. They built it to surveil us. But it's blown up in their face, Owen.
Well, it's inevitable. That's a beast. That's how it's going to end. I mean, you can't stop something. It's like all of these people are warning us about artificial intelligence. You know, we see stories breaking about artificial intelligence being the next big threat to humanity.
They're already replacing all the cars, the ships. The elite want to get rid of us. It's not that AI is bad. The elite are designing it to be anti-human from the beginning.
And if it gets out of control, they're not going to be able to save themselves, but they're delusional enough. It, you know, that's the typical mindset. That's the psychology.
No, I've learned the average elitist thinks they're God. Rob, do you want to pop in?
Just adjusting my light. But I'm still amazed that they're sitting here talking about splitting hairs at this point. I wish, you know, I'm not complaining, I guess. We've only been here an hour and 40 minutes.
I think it was better before you aimed the light over your head. It's like the reverse, the little kid with the flashlight.
This is actually one of our track lights. I just popped it over because we're lighting up McBreen to make him look good.
Hey, can you make yourself, for a minute, just act fake liberal, act like you're really important for a minute. Let's all just sit back and go.
Actually, this shirt isn't from the year 2000. It's from 2002.
Mess up your hair a little bit.
You know, I've been working here for a total of 3 years, 632 days, and 42 minutes. And, you know, I'd like to thank everybody.
Integrity.
I'd like to thank my control guy. What's your name again? Marcos? Hi. Steve. Yeah, I'd like to. Yeah, we're really working hard today. And, you know, it's sad that we've kind of come to this at 3 in the morning. But, you know, it's how did we get here? Assange came out and was going to make this announcement, and then supposedly he's gotten death threats on his life, and he was going to make it from the balcony, kind of make this big production. And it's interesting because they show photos of him. Pull up that photo of him on the balcony. That looks pretty, you know, that would be pretty historic.
Presidential.
Him getting on there and so, look, here's the documents, you know, shaking his. But now we're in like a little theater in Berlin with people passing around microphones, you know. And
it's like a small little venue too. It kind of looks like almost like a liberal little college hangout
house.
Or something.
It's a coffee house type atmosphere.
Yeah. I mean, whatever, get the leaks out.
I guess now they're taking questions from the audience. Maybe we should
or from the journalists.
Yeah, like, where's Assange? Let's get to the meat and potatoes.
Yeah.
Infowars.com.
The Americans are impatient.
Yeah, so we've had some media partnerships for some smaller size
publications with
cable gate. Even in the summer, we had with the Afghan warlocks, for example, a sort of smaller size one than we then came to have with about three or four partners. And as we rolled out Cablegate, essentially what it was is that as we would start to publish the cables to do with a certain region or country, we would basically analyze the media in that country and look at who had the best investigative teams and would therefore do justice to the material. Often we got more than one in each country. We actually discovered working with some
By the way,
media
I want to say
that,
something. It's like Snowden giving the Washington Post his story. They call for his arrest and execution. I love how WikiLeaks, and this is just a criticism, I love WikiLeaks, I love Assange, but he's still mainstream media reporters who literally think because they can write an article, they're God. There's a lot of arrogance here on average that we're seeing today. And with Snowden, they screwed him over. And so that's why everybody should just do their own journalist, their own report, so it's more pure. Because that's what this comes down to. You're seeing Infowars.com, live coverage of the WikiLeaks hour-and-a-half press conference. We're 42 minutes into it. In the next 10, 15 minutes, Assange is going to show up. It's what we're all waiting for right now. We've kind of gotten the history of WikiLeaks. It's very interesting. The problem is that the people doing the presentation are so cool, they can't kind of bring themselves to give us any information. And I'm not trying to be mean. It's just that this is why I get called 10 times a day. Sometimes like 30, 40 big profiles, New York Times, Washington Post, you name it, in the last few months. And I just said, I'm not doing it because I don't have time to sit there on a weird power trip with some journalist for a day so they write some twisted article. Just write whatever you're going to write. So my deal is InfoWars, Drudge Report, we're the future, we're huge. WikiLeaks is great, but it's good to see how unpretentious Drudge is or how unpretentious InfoWars is because these folks are great. It's just, my God, who puts together these productions? Get right to it. I would, you know, give a five-minute history of what we've done, five-minute history of what we've been through, and then get to the data dump. Get to the meat and potatoes now, now, now. That's
Alex,
what we want.
When Andrew Breitbart came out and said he's got this amazing video. I think it was at some straw pack or something.
And
something,
he died a day later.
Yeah, and then he died. And then the stuff they released, it didn't quite live up to what you thought it would be.
That's right. Okay, she's now gone to a new video. Let's go to her. We love WikiLeaks.
Against Visa and MasterCard, and we're in the damages phase of that. So hopefully over the next few months and year, there will be some updates on that case. But we are being successful as that progresses.
They are getting a lot of folks exposed.
We, of course, had
the clearinghouse where all the people send their data.
Electronic, some of it mass surveillance, and some of it obviously targeted. Julian Assange is in an embassy where, although there was...
This is only the beginning, though, of exposing all this. This is history happening. Julian Assange is coming. It's 10 minutes. Press conference from Germany. Infowars.com, live coverage. Infowars.com/show. And what really happens is, once he gives us the dirt, we start investigating it. We put the reports out first. We counter the globalist controlled narrative. Let's go back to Sarah Harrison and the WikiLeaks.
The U.S. grand jury case against us and the surveillance that we get. A couple of Christmases ago, I got a lovely Christmas present from Google where they sent me, finally, after having been keeping it secret for 2 years, they sent me the subpoena that they'd had on my emails. Now, it was interesting that this was a private email account before I joined WikiLeaks, so this really goes to show the dragnet nature of the investigation in the United States that Melinda will talk more about in a second. And just before she comes on, I just sort of want to say that we've really seen with the grand jury in the U.S. from a member of staff that this is really, we can see that it is trying to get our boss, our editor-in-chief, Julian Assange, but it's quite quite worrying for all of us as members of staff that they're willing to go to these lengths, where my private emails, you know, with my family, etc., were caught up in this dragnet surveillance to try and get Julian on criminal codes such as espionage, conspiracy to commit espionage, computer fraud and abuse acts. These are all very serious crimes in the United States. And this is on top of something I just want to illustrate now, because I think it shows it quite well. This sort of surveillance and these sorts of secret legal threats that the US government has been, or the US has been making against us, have also come from a number of government officials in quite a personal way ever since 2010 they began.
Information warfare is warfare, and Julian Assange is engaged in warfare. Information terrorism, which leads to people getting killed, is terrorism, and Julian Assange is engaged in terrorism. He should be treated as an enemy combatant. WikiLeaks should be closed down permanently and decisively.
Should the United States do something to stop Mr. Assange?
We're looking at that right now. The Justice Department is taking a look at that. I would argue that it's closer to being in the high-tech terrorist than the Pentagon Papers.
This disclosure is not just an attack on America's foreign policy interests. It is an attack on the international community.
The head of WikiLeaks is not a particularly credible source in my mind. He's a criminal, and he ought to be hunted down and grabbed and then put on trial for what he's done here.
I think the man is a high-tech terrorist. He's done in the sons. He needs to be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law, and if that becomes a problem, we need to change the law.
Well, I think Assange should be assassinated, actually. I think Obama should put out a contract and maybe use a drone or something.
You don't want to act panicked and have the...
Well, you don't have to act panicked. You can act tough and say, if we catch you, we're going to hang you.
Yeah. Well,
whatever.
We heard some of that from Mueller.
Julian Assange is a cyber terrorist in wartime. He's guilty of sabotage, espionage, crimes against humanity. He should be killed.
How is it that the WikiLeaks guy remains free? You know, back in the old days when men were men and countries were countries, this guy would die of lead poisoning from a bullet in the brain, and nobody would know who put it there.
The way to deal with this is pretty simple. We got special ops forces. I mean, the dead man can't leak stuff. This guy's a traitor, a treasonist, and he has broken every law of the United States. The guy ought to be, and I'm not for the death penalty, so if I'm not for the death penalty, I'm going to do it. Illegally shoot the son of a...
It's time that the Obama administration treats WikiLeaks for what it is, a terrorist organization whose continued operation threatens our security. Shut it down. Shut it down. It is time to shut down this terrorist organization, this terrorist website, WikiLeaks. Shut it down, Attorney General Holder.
Wow. Okay, we're going to go back to WikiLeaks here in a moment. Assange is coming up. They're about 7 minutes behind. So Assange will come up, it looks like, at about 4:06 Central. That'll be 5:06 Eastern. We're going to be covering it all live. But we can say that WikiLeaks puts on a bad TV promotion and kind of has a guy who looks like he rolled out of bed. But they are great patriots. We're making jokes here in the middle of the night. We want to get to the meat and potatoes. But to say they're terrorists exposing crimes of multinationals that have hijacked this country and government drug dealing and Fast and Furious and Hillary creating ISIS and funding Al-Qaeda, they're patriots. So here's a Julian Assange who was going to go out on that balcony and has such great courage. And here's these folks, too, who are writers. They're not really, you know, TV people trying to go out and do that. So they're doing a great job. I want to go back to this new lady that's on screen. But briefly, I want to point out we're listener supported. We don't really go off sponsorship. InfoWarsStore.com. InfoWarsLife.com, our great new probiotic biome defense, Hillary for Prison shirts, all sorts of great radio systems, non-GMO seeds, heirloom seeds, InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, and check out the products and support true independent nationalist media. Also support Right Side Broadcasting Network, RSBN.TV. They're totally listener-supported. Go there and make a donation and see all their great hosts and work they're doing, RSBN.TV. I'm Alex Jones with live coverage. Assange is coming up in about 17 minutes. They're behind schedule. But let's go to whoever this journalist is. I guess she's Melinda Taylor, lawyer for Julian Assange on legal threats and status just went up. Here she is.
Services to their Swedish counterpart. It was underlined that please do not think that this case is being dealt with as just another extradition request. And why was that? It's because the long arm of the US had reached out to its allies and indicated that it wanted Assange by any means possible.
The long arm of the globalist.
As a result, it's the ever-present risk of being carted off to face an unfair and abusive prosecution in the US that forms the bars that keeps Julian indefinitely detained. The complex legal decisions and actions that have given rise to this indefinite detention can be distilled to a few simple and irrefutable facts. There is an ongoing national security prosecution of both Julian and WikiLeaks.
That's right. This is getting good. This is what should have been day one. Her lawyer, then Assange. This is good. I'm going to shut up.
History. And it is the largest cybersecurity prosecution in the U.S. Army. This prosecution has already given rise to several legal abuses and mistreatment. Chelsea Manning was interrogated in relation to both Julian Assange and WikiLeaks. The UN Special Rapporteur on Torture found that the interrogation methods applied to her amounted to torture. As Sarah mentioned, in 2012, the Department of Justice issued secret subpoenas to Google to obtain email accounts with private, personal, privileged information, and there was barely a whimper of protest before they were given up.
Share this link, folks. You are the InfoWars. Share the link.
28th of January, 2015, a spokesperson
change the election
for the Eastern District of Virginia confirmed the criminal investigation into Julian is ongoing. And the risk presented by
the prosecution
has grown in the last few
years.
The
risk is you don't take action. Attack.
Is a thorn in the side of U.S. politicians who would prefer that their dirty secrets and mistakes are hidden from the very people who have the power to either elect or dismiss them. The inability to view Julian or WikiLeaks with any level of impartiality has just been emphasized by the recent smear campaign caused by the DNC leaks. Once again, the specter of Reds Under the Beds has been resurrected. Just because WikiLeaks dared to publish information, for example, about Hillary Clinton's policy failings and her short-sighted and flawed approach to international interventions, for example, in Libya. He published this, therefore he must be anti-American. He must be an enemy of state. They don't see him as a publisher. They see him as an enemy combatant who must be brought to heel by any means possible.
Now this lady's good. This is what we should have been hearing day one.
Placed
on sorry, a couple of trendies bubbling around is not good.
Along with other members of terrorist organizations. And as Sarah mentioned, there was reports that came out recently that Hillary Clinton, in a meeting, proposed to just drone the guy. And while this has been going on, both Sweden and the United Kingdom have refused to give any assurances that he won't be handed over to the US if he were to go to Sweden. And of course, they hide behind technical reasons for their refusal. Oh, we haven't received a formal request from the US for his extradition. Or we can only give him an assurance that he won't be given to the US after he leaves the embassy and after he comes to Sweden. It's just like the big bad wolf who's outside the doors of the Ecuadorian embassy. He's tried to huff and puff and blow it down. And now he's trying to convince Julian to leave. Come out, Julian. I might be chomping on a Chelsea Manning sandwich. That might be Edward Snowden in a frying pan behind me, but you'll be safe if you come. And so the stalemate continues. Julian remains detained because the UK and Sweden continue to flout their international obligations and their duty to protect him from this risk. But even though Julian has been locked up, they haven't been able to silence him or WikiLeaks.
That's right. More people are copying.
Over the last
DC
five
leaks,
years,
you name it.
Whilst Julian was detained,
killing that DC staffer didn't help, did it?
Key information that has changed the world.
Walking around on the pier, Mark Dice should do this video, walking around asking people, have you ever heard of Julian Assange?
He doesn't like Hillary. We want to kill him. They'd be like, yeah, let's kill that son of a bitch.
and the shadowy outlines of brick
bombs. He's trying to take Hillary, murder him. Stop him. Stop Assange for Hillary. Stop Assange for Obama.
You wonder how Nazi Germany happened. A bunch of people just got behind their leader and did whatever they said. Group thing. Need to get out of that. Here, let's go back to her.
It was the detailed minutia of
Julian Assange's lawyer.
Excesses that were set out and leaked U.S. diplomatic cables that acted as a catalyst for the Arab Spring. But the diplomatic emails and cables leaked by WikiLeaks were also instrumental in revealing the political machinations that both preceded and accompanied the NATO intervention in Libya. For example, one can see in Hillary Clinton's emails that she was aware of the profile of Saif Gaddafi as a potential.
See, this is a prelude to her killing Gaddafi on purpose, which we broke today first. Well, from the ambassador and the former Black Caucus leader. This is a prelude to her arming the rebels. Because that was, he said, part of it is her arming Al-Qaeda turning into ISIS. So we've been, she's preluding.
Between securing oil contracts as compared to protecting civilian lives. So these documents have had a range of repercussions in a range of areas. They're used by both the Victims Council and Defense Council international courts and tribunals. And that is because they help to establish the truth. Truth might be a universal value, but it's a rare commodity. Not everyone has equal access to authentic evidence. If you're a sitting head of state or a head of a multinational corporation, often you can conjure up documents at a minute's notice. But if you're a human rights defender, a political opponent, or a dissenter, it's very hard to get access to evidence to help prove claims or protect your rights. But by making troves of authentic documents freely available, WikiLeaks has leveled the legal playing field. Thanks to WikiLeaks, you don't have to be a government crony or an insider to get information concerning, for example, the collateral murder of civilians and journalists in Iraq, mistreatment of detainees in Guantanamo Bay, U.S. spying on foreign diplomats, unfair and unbalanced trade agreements. Today's event has been convened to mark the 10th year anniversary.
And by the way, I'm not bragging, but clearly they're going to go with Hillary funding radical Islam and Al-Qaeda. That's going to be one of the big deals. We broke it with Tosh Plumlee, Colonel Schaefer, Steve McChenning, years before WikiLeaks did. And good for them. I'm glad they're there. I wish they'd break the whole thing and defeat them, but understand Infowars.com, tip of the spear, baby. And I'm very proud of our crew and what we've done here. Let's continue with the live WikiLeaks coverage in association with Right Side Broadcasting, RSBN.tv.
I would like to thank Julie.
Yeah, I just lost audio. Have we lost the feed here? Let's go back. Right Side Broadcasting lost their feed.
WikiLeaks film.
The UN decision, just so that you can get the wording of that, that Melinda was just...
Yeah, this is Germany, bounced through Virginia, bounced through Austin. We're going to have some problems. This is Christopher. How do you pronounce his name?
Since his arrest,
I think it's Pushaw.
With a video. As a result of this is the UN press conference, correct? This is the UN press conference video.
Yes.
All right, here we go. La chambonté des petits de con. J'étends la moulouque le bleu bleu. Sorry, I can speak French, yeah? You like that?
Integrity and freedom of movement, and affording the right to compensation.
And despite that UN ruling that came several months ago, Julian is still in the Ecuadorian embassy in London, although hopefully via video to us right now.
All right, they're trying to get Assange on. This is the moment we've been waiting for. We better hear some major dirt. And I've been told by Stone and others they've been in contact with him. We're about to get, quote...
We heard that, Julian.
Devastation of the Clintons.
All right, that's great.
Devastation. We're up at 4 a.m. Central.
Weirdly echoing, sort of in an omnipresent...
I'm trying to figure out equipment right now.
I hope this is so big that we can...
Why didn't they call InfoWars and we'd have it all spotlessly run? Why do we have to have a bunch of scurrying around here?
Come on now.
Come on now.
This one goes there.
That way.
That one goes there.
Aim the crosshairs this way. Pull the trigger that way. There, sink the enemy. That's how it's done. Pull the knife across the throat like that, across the carotids. Press in lovingly. Watch the blood spray. politically.
Okay, just sort
of stab him a few times right in the stomach for good measure.
For just a couple of seconds, does anybody have a question from the?
It looks like they've restarted the computer.
Trying to set that up, that
as if they're not going to hack. I said try to keep Assange off. I mean, it might be technical difficulties too, but this is like you're about to have Julian Assange, millions watching across the world, not just here. We literally have hundreds of thousands watching internet streams right now. We're up at 4 in the morning Central, 5 here, and we're just having fun. We're being honest, you know. We're here bitching that we're up in the middle of the night. We want to hear this. Infowars.com/show.
The specific announcement, the sort of... I know it sounds a bit bad, but it's a bit of a get-out clause, but obviously the nature of sort of a security issue for him is one that we can't really go...
No, I get it. He can't be on the balcony. But his security, he better get the dirt out.
Happy birthday.
Here we go. Go to Assange. Full broadcast. Infowars.com coverage. Here we go.
This is true. It's not Ruth, actually. I actually didn't hear much of what went on because you need to be close to the mic that's connected to the business. But, okay, so I understand we're in the Volkswagen, and I have to thank the Volkswagen for again for letting us use that space. It's a quite important place in the building. Okay, so let me get my notes and we'll begin. We have about 20 minutes, is that right? We're running a little over time. Right?
Yeah.
So I'll try and cut it to 15 so we have time for questions. Over the last 10 years, WikiLeaks has released 10 million documents comprising of 10 million words. And why numbers are not everything, they're a start. That information, part of it, never would have existed in the world had we not released it. It would have been stored away somewhere privately, but it wouldn't have become part of our collective civilizational knowledge. And it corresponds to approximately 3,000 documents a day on average. That's a hell of a lot of work. That's why we don't release every single day. We do things at scale in order to, say, release 100,000 documents at once. But it does pan out to about 3,000 documents per day. Now, why do this at all? I am in a position where I've been detained without charge here in the UK, one form or another, prison, house arrest, the last 4 years in the embassy. As a result of this work, some of our sources, or alleged sources, have suffered terrible consequences in the United States. Actually, not many. We have thousands, and there's only a couple of alleged sources that are facing difficulty, but altogether, in sources and supporters, people have been sentenced to something like 50 years altogether. And the two most significant cases is that of Chelsea Manning in the United States, sentenced to 35 years in prison, purely for communicating.
And he's offered to turn himself in if they'll let Chelsea Manning out.
There's no other allegation.
We're watching live WikiLeaks coverage of the Julian Assange press conference at Infowars.com and RSBN.tv, Right Side Broadcasting News.
Subject to cruel and inhumane treatment, akin to torture. Jeremy Hammond, who imprisoned in New York, for 10 years. And then a number of supporters back in the heat of the kind of first phase of neo-McCarthyist hysteria in the United States. In 2010-2011, went through a legal process as well. Most of them got off without any imprisonment. But, okay, what does it teach you? Well, it teaches you something about the structure of power. Whenever WikiLeaks engages in a release...
Again, we're trying to fix their audio. They've just got an open mic in a huge room.
About the institution or about
A little bit better. This is Julian Assange speaking.
Is interesting. But also the reactions by the institution of the state, and it's been revealing, and the reactions by tertiary players, such as particular media groups and their alignment, allied institutions, and so on. I mean, this in some ways harkens back to the old statement of Voltaire, that if you want to understand structural power, you should see who it is that you have difficulty writing about. Well, for myself, my staff, and our sources, we believe in some kind of romantic ideal. It's quite a quaint notion. It's quite a legal notion. It's quite a notion, in fact, that perhaps in some ways doesn't belong to this time. It belongs to an older time, perhaps a future time, which is that through understanding the world, we can do something sane. We can do something rational. It's not something of coming out of a postmodernist view of extremely bounded rationality, the way that we're just trying to point it. But we actually, it's fascinating to understand the world around us, and through this understanding, we can see justice come from it, as we have in many cases, some of which Sarah has pointed out. In fact, you can break down this quest for knowledge and understanding into really the three types of history. By history, journalists will understand that I don't mean what happened 100 years ago, or not only what happened 100 years ago. I mean history so for now, the history that is unfolding all around us. What are the three types? So type one, the history which is subsidized, where there is economic interest in propelling it and promotion. That, of course, includes all kinds of advertising and propaganda. But it also includes very basic things, such as how to hammer in particular types of nails, how to build a pump, how to buy a pump.
All right, we're trying to figure out exactly what's being said here, ladies and gentlemen, just like everybody else. Julian Assange is here with millions watching around the world. I think he just said talked about building a pub or something. So we're trying to figure this out right now.
It's economic subsidy. Knowledge which is no longer fulfilled in the world, but sits there and perhaps slowly decays. That's important to try in some cases to drive that knowledge. But generally speaking, it's not kept around because people don't find it interesting enough to keep around. And then there's the type three history.
None of them think to bring the mic close to the speaker. It's like way back in the back of the room, they're all just acting liberal, like, ugh, liberal, ugh. And they can't even hear.
I'm honestly shocked at the two-bit nature of this so far.
Well, I mean, I don't want to be negative or mean here, but we're just going to be honest. It's all we can do. This is a frickin' train wreck. And I'm glad my crew came in and worked really hard tonight. We are like 10 minutes into incoherent babble. I mean, can I just hear like Baggins Shire so I can like send the ring race where this is at? I mean, because I'm sitting here and we've got him over the hot coals here. And again, in the incoherent babbling, you're hearing anything?
I'm struggling to make out a lot of what he's saying. I've been trying to hear the words Clinton or Democrats or U.S. election. I haven't really heard any of those key words.
Well, in case he's doing it, let's go back to it. We're just not intellectual enough to understand this. Here, let's go back to it.
That's a rich documentation of the history of a war. In fact, the history of two countries that would not have otherwise.
History of countries, that's a large, large history.
For those countries or for the other countries that were involved in those wars to understand and derive lessons from. So through...
maybe this will be better when they put the HD out with actual audio.
Will they? And if they can, why aren't they? We just plug directly into that. Now we've got questions on the broadcast.
We can't even get. Oh, people bitch when the NFL has like 3 minutes of darkness, you know, power outage. This is a train wreck.
I think Alexandria. I think we probably have more documents than Alexandria.
Okay, yeah, more documents than Santa Claus ever shit out of his ass. We get it. Now give us some documentation.
We have the first month of weed bringing to the world in prison, as opposed to copies of other books, which might be interesting, but we're in the quest of trying to find original documents that have never been seen before and bringing them.
I know, you got the best damn documents. Show them to us.
Understand. Okay, so Sarah has spoken about some of the technical details and a bit of our practical history. I want to speak now about some of the things we're doing going forward, the future of WikiLeaks. Well, I know this. I've seen the internet, and I understand that there's enormous expectation in the United States.
Yeah, there's enormous expectation.
Some of that expectation will be partly answered.
It's built up by him. Here we go.
We understand that if we're going to make a major publication in relation to the United States at a particular hour, we don't do it at 3 a.m. That's something.
We don't do it at 3 a.m. What this is like, it is a troll to get him to tune into the WikiLeaks so these idiots can get on TV with their hair sticking up. He just admitted it. We don't do it at 3 a.m. Oh, my God.
WikiLeaks has grown
and with Hillary,
into
I guess.
A relatively strong position. We're a publishing organization.
I just tweeted that out. WikiLeaks is trolling the world, but I put out a link.
He actually said that? Or did you tweet that?
Just tweeted that. It's happening right
he just
now.
Said we don't release this at 3 a.m. It's actually 5 a.m. Eastern.
So what is this, a ceremony?
It's all 10 years. They have a bunch of weird women up there.
I mean, I thought the lawyer was good.
We're completely independent. We're not narcissistic at all. But did you see me in the mirror and all the ladies that love me?
Look at our high-quality broadcast.
If you can make out a single word of it, you are a genius.
But nonetheless...
Nonetheless...
...the material that is going to publish before the end of the year is of a significant...
Before the end of the year? He's made a deal! Before the election, jackass! 34 days! 34! Private pile! 34! 34, private pile! What is that? It's a goddamn jelly donut! And why don't we have jelly donuts? Because you are a disgusting liberal fop!
Devastating. Devastating.
Operation
I think Alex Jones is losing it. There's Julius Assange, dude, man. God. His own people probably can't even understand the guy. What a joke. I might as well just join in with Alex Jones and them. Of course not with the crude content, but what a joke.
On a number of elements.
Headline, Julian Assange trolls the world. Hillary wants to kill you, Julian. Come on. No, he made a deal. I don't want to say that, but that's what this is leading. Talk about him. Real asylum. Is she all the women that like me? Real asylum.
If necessary, of course.
Julian Assange has done some good work. I'm not going to take that away from him.
The Ecuadorian people.
Hey, we have our own leaks.
We have to react to this broadcast. I mean,
we have to be honest. It's all we got.
I mean, I'm just watching the broadcast in reaction, reacting to it.
I love the hammered audio. That's the best part.
Hey, you know what?
Who has better audio? What?
AP?
We have engaged in a new project.
Right, bring AP back up.
The censorship, and we will also give call to arms.
His audio is not much better. I come to you from Clandatho, home world of the bug people.
Which I expect almost.
I have bugs living in my brain.
What else?
Yeah, what else? If you're all looking for some giant data dump, we don't do it at 3 a.m. Troll! Back a chicken womb. Move, bitch! Get out the way! Get out the way, bitch! Get out the way! He's like three spliffs, double crowns, gold chains, machine guns.
Membership system. Where we will give voting rights in relation to 20% of the discretionary expenditure we have. It's important to keep us independent and keep a sustained and predictable income as opposed to significant income coming from the times of publication, but in the times of Supreme publications, where there's extensive litigation, then the funding is more unpredictable, which is a difficult position to be in if you're in the middle of litigation. Okay, on upcoming journalism, because we have so many publications due before the end of the year, we're in a
boat. We've got to have other people get the leaks, not just WikiLeaks. This has become a loggerhead, a long jam. It's become a big traffic jam.
Well, I'm just confused why he's saying devastating. I mean, he's the one
that... Devastating! Incredible info said a month ago.
So he said something about by the end of the year. But anyways, I'm getting ready to cut off Alex Jones and... I'm gonna conclude this thing with Coast to Coast.
Is it true? Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
Increase our number of press partnerships. We have about 110 different organizations over the years. I think it's about 89 active at the moment.
He did the big tell. He goes, by the end of the year, they're going to wait till the election's over and release whatever it is.
Who's got a bigger man piece, Michelle Obama or Julian Assange right now?
Julian, listen.
We're not trying to be mean to Julian Assange.
Oh, the two trannies. She's definitely got the bigger guy.
This has been...
It must be an agreement. Okay. Now... upcoming publications. We hope to be publishing every week for the next 10 weeks. Now, we have on schedule, and it's a very hard schedule, all the U.S. election-related documents to come out before November 8th. Our upcoming series include significant material from war, on arms, on oil, on Google, on the US election, and on mass surveillance. So journalists who are interested in those subjects, please write to press@wikileaks.org. We will be beginning the first publication in that series this week. I'm not going to specify the hour because, of course, all the press blacks get ready to try and spin in the other direction. Okay, so finally, so we can get on to questions, there's a lot of thank yous. I'm going to avoid 10 years worth of thank yous. Needless to say, an endeavor like WikiLeaks comes about as a result of the efforts of a great many people and institutions, common allies, love of what we're doing, and in some cases, sympathy and the thrill of doing something that's important. So I don't want to give a map of the people by thanking them. But that necessarily isn't a suggestion that everyone I'm about to mention is not important. It's a mixture. First of all, the committed team of brave technicians and journalistic staff that make WikiLeaks what it is, which is an organization which has technical understanding at its core. That is our speciality, that is our imperative. Our sources, of course, without which none of this is possible. We will always keep your trust and do the best, get the best feedback possible for you, showing over the years that we do. Our readers, supporters, and defenders who keep our mission going, a lot of staff and a lot of legal battles, a lot of money. It's only through the funding of our readers and supporters that we're able to keep that leadership going. Our increasingly formidable legal team, they're public, so it can be named, including Balthazar Gazon, Barry Pollack, Margaret Kunstler, United States, Lynn Taylor, Gareth Pierce, Philippa Morris, Renata Abilia, Kerry Shankman, Jennifer Robinson, Julian Burnside, Greg Barnes, and more than 100 other lawyers in different countries, nearly all of whom work pro bono, although their expenses. Our allies, media partners, and other defenders in hundreds of institutions and countries, especially the Center for Constitutional Rights in the United States, FFDN, Reporters Sans Frontiers, Human Rights Watch, the ACLU, and the Freedom of Press Foundation in the United States. Professor Gavin McFadden, who's in a very difficult way at the moment in terms of his health, Susan Penn, and John Silger, who should be personally thanked. The people and government of Ecuador, the United Nations, who courageously respected my human rights, despite considerable pressure over the years. The people of Germany, the Holland Foundation, Der Spiegel, the Deutsche Zeitung, the CCC, Angela and Daniel Richter, John Dirks, and there's many others who I mentioned. And last, but perhaps most significantly, those who died fighting in this business, Michael Ratner, chief legal counsel, John Jones, who together with Linda Taylor presented our UN decision, Aaron Schwartz, Lenny Weinblatt, another one of our lawyers, rest in power. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Julian. So we have some time to take some questions. Yep, sure.
There's been a lot of speculation in the US that the leaks are about to come out, that they have destroyed
the Julian, do you want to take that one? Because I think it's the false quoting of you that's being the issue on some of this. Sorry. It was a referring to, do we have any comments on whether the upcoming publications to do with the US elections will destroy Clinton or not?
There's been a lot of misquoting of me and WikiLeaks publications. In this particular case, the misquoting has to do with that we intend to harm Hillary Clinton, or that I intend to harm Hillary Clinton, I'd like Hillary Clinton. All those are false. They come about as a result, principally, it seems, of this campaign and defenders trying to personalize our publication. are upcoming publications significant in relation to the U.S. election? Yeah, we think they're significant. Do they show interesting features of U.S. Power factions and how they operate? Yes, they do.
Any other questions?
Julian also implied that there's been some kind of threat towards the Ecuadorian people as a result of Ecuador giving Julian the flight. Can you elaborate more on exactly what kind of pressures they're under?
Julian, do you want to... the question is, you seem to have referenced that Ecuador or the Ecuadorian people have been threatened because of the decision to give you asylum. Is that what you said, stroke meant, and can you elaborate anymore?
I didn't say threatened. I said that there's been pressure. It is, if you read the Ecuadorian press, you see some of that in play in relation to other forms of pressure and developments. In the United States, in response to our upcoming publications and the DNC leaks, we have a lot of sources, and those sources are in U.S. politics.
All right, folks, I guess I've heard enough, and you've probably heard enough, so I think this has been nothing more than just a 10-year anniversary of WikiLeaks. He didn't have anything to say about anything on our elections. It's just questions and answers time now. It's just been a big old train wreck. Train wreck of a broadcast, that, as Alex Jones put it. It's been one big joke. A joke on the media of the world. Well, goodbye, Julia Assange. Cutting you off right now. Good night, everybody. This has been the Michael Tobin Show at an unprecedented hour, historical hour, starting just after midnight Pacific time, and it's 2:29 now. So it's been about 2 hours and 15 minutes at least, and everybody is up on the East Coast watching this thing, and this whole broadcast has been originating from Germany, which is about six hours ahead of Eastern time. So it was right about lunchtime for them. And anyways, you'll hear all about it. But at least you got most of the broadcast here on the Michael Tobin Show. God bless you. Have a good night. Good morning.